Good evening and welcome to the public lecture series for CONTAGION. We are Science Gallery Bengaluru, public institution for research-based engagement. We are a part of an international network of galleries and we have 8 other sibling galleries across the world. CONTAGION is our 4th exhibition, but our first fully online exhibition season. There couldn't be both a more apt, but yet a more terrifying moment in which to hold this exhibition season. We are delighted to have the support of the Indian National Science Academy for this lecture series. And I would like to thank Professor Chandrima Shah for her continued support for this, for our programming. Today's lecture on plant viruses is by George Lomonossoff from the John Innes Center. George obtained both his BA and PhD from the University of Cambridge and joined the John Innes Center, Norwich in 1980. His research has focused on molecular biology of RNA plant viruses and their use in bio and nanotechnology. In 2012, he was named the BBSRC Innovator of the Year for his work on plant-made pharmaceuticals. And in 2015, he delivered the Microbiology Society Kohlberg Prize Lecture. The transient expression system he developed is used worldwide and is currently deployed by Leaf Expression Systems, Norwich, to scale up production of plant-made products. Before I hand over the mic to George, I'd like to let all of you know that we program bilingually, so all our exhibitions are in English as well as Kannada. And because not enough people have notice this yet, we are going to launch, we're going to launch specially the Kannada part of our work tomorrow with Vishu Guttal, professor at the Indian Institute of Science at 4 p.m. The registration links to all these programs are available in the chat box. Please do type your questions in the Q&A box and do give us your feedback because we would like to know how we are doing, we would like to know what you liked, and we would like to know how we can improve going forward. Handing over to George, and you may share your screen now. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for that very nice introduction. And thanks to the organizer for giving me this chance to present some of the work on my favorite subject, which is viruses. And also thanks to all of you for taking the time to listen to this, wherever you are in the world, of course, when these things are online, and whether it's in the evening in India or midday, lunchtime, as it is here in the UK, or if you're listening from somewhere like North America, it'll be the early morning. So thank you all for coming. So what I'm going to talk about is what we know about viruses, a bit of the history, a lot of which the early work was done on plant viruses, and how actually we can use that work or our understanding of viruses to turn what are you think of as actually rather unpleasant things, adversaries, into allies in the fight against various diseases. So I work at the John Innes Centre in Norwich, and that's a city in the eastern part of England, just here. I work at a plant and microbial institute, and I've been there for, well, it's over 40 years now. So I'm almost part of the furniture, I think. And this is one of the parts of it. And I just get a laser pointer, and I actually currently work in that building. And looks like a picture as usual is taken on a nice sunny day. I have to say it's not always like that. So virus diseases, they're very much in the news at the moment, of course, with COVID-19, but they've actually been recognized for many, many years. I mean, since antiquity. But of course, the causative agents weren't understood. I mean, we have evidence from the past about some of the ravages. So for instance, in this case, we have a tomb carving from ancient Egypt. And this person, who I think is a priest, seems to have the symptoms, characteristic symptoms of leg weakness associated with poliovirus. And although you can't actually prove he was infected with that, there is a suggestion that it was very much around in ancient Egyptian times. More recently, and rather more precisely documented, were in medieval era, and especially in the Renaissance, where there's this series of paintings by the painter Justus Suttermans of an infection within the Medici family. And this is Ferdinand II of the Medici, and actually painted 7 and 9 days after contracting smallpox. And so we actually have a detailed early understanding of the progression of the disease. Now, of course, in all these cases, although people were aware of the scourge of these viral diseases, there was no understanding of the causative agent. And I should point out that it was also understood that it's not just animals that get virus diseases, but plants do as well. And so this is a modern photograph of a cassava field. And actually here you can see healthy cassava plants, and that they're used to produce manioc from the roots, very important staple food. But these plants get a disease called, in this case, African cassava mosaic virus. And they get this kind of mosaic on the leaves, they're stunted, and they produce far less of the nutritional ingredient that you grow these plants for. So that's a big economic problem and a big sort of human nutrition problem. But they also cause rather unusual symptoms on ornamental plants. And there's a classic example in tulips. And a lot of you may have actually seen this effect. This is this kind of breaking of the color of a tulip. And this is actually associated, it's not a genetic feature that you get a true breeding variety. It's actually that this is caused by a virus infection, by a type of virus called a potivirus. And it's infected bulbs, which give you this kind of broken flower. Now this is actually known as the variety Semper Augustus. And in the 17th century in the Netherlands, these kind of effects were highly prized. And actually led to an odd kind of condition, I don't think you can call it a disease, in humans, called tulipomania, whereby people highly prized these bulbs, and led to a huge speculative bubble at the time, where people, you know, putting their family fortune to buy a new bulb, one of these things like a Semper Augustus, there were various other ones. Because, of course, the breeding of these was, you know, it wasn't a simple trait. These things would emerge suddenly. So it was all very mysterious and what was happening. But then there were various satirical paintings at the time. And this is from Jan Bruegel the Younger, where he's showing how this kind of mania, where he represents the various merchants as monkeys dressed in clothes to show the kind of sort of insanity that took over, and people were buying these bulbs at exorbitant prices. And, you know, of course, you realize there's not actually that much you can do with them apart from selling them on. Therefore, it's a very speculative bubble. And this led to this sort of one of the earliest examples of a boom and bust in 1636. And you can see suddenly people get very, very interested, start buying the tulips, the price rockets until people can't actually afford to buy them anymore. And then everyone looks around and says, is there actually any point to these? And so the price just collapses and people lost their fortunes on that. So that's a plant virus causing an economic bubble. It's not per se the disease which is the problem, as it would be with cassava, you know, and the loss of crops, but the influence it has on human behavior. So by the 19th century, there was a lot of understanding that a lot of diseases were transmissible. Obviously, diseases can also be hereditary, or you can also have, you know, conditions inborn errors in metabolism can cause disease. And these aren't transmissible. But that was widely recognized, and you can read accounts of, say, for instance, the Plague of London, and Samuel Pepys kept a diary about that, you know, the spread of it. And people understood that you avoided infected individuals in that case. These were transmissible conditions. And of course, other ones such as cholera and tuberculosis, etc. So isolation we'd now call it social distancing, I guess, was widely practiced before and up to the 19th century and to this day. And by the 19th century, there was a lot of information of actually what caused these kind of diseases. And these were agents which could be cultured. You could grow them on an agar plate. You could actually see the organism under a light microscope. And this is one of the classic kind of things, much beloved of photos of scientists, particularly in the 19th century, a light microscope. They're visible under that. So you could see these were a living organism, and you could filter them out. You can sterile filter, and it's a technique actually used to this day. They will be retained, and the filtrate you get through is non-infectious. And so there was a general feeling that it was bacteria that caused diseases, and people like Louis Pasteur and Robert Koch were very much involved in all that work. However, there were certain infections that did not fit those criteria. You couldn't grow them on a plate. You couldn't see them. And so there was a lot of sort of mystery surrounding, what they were. And there was some work in the very late 19th century which gave some ideas of what was causing these kind of diseases. And there are two people who are generally regarded as, I suppose, the fathers of virology. And the first I'm going to mention is Dmitry Ivanovsky, in St. Petersburg, and he published a paper in 1892 where he took a disease, a condition from tobacco in the Crimea, and took disease plants and showed that he could actually filter extracts from those plants. And in the stuff which came through the filter, which would normally retain bacteria, that material was still infectious to other plants. So he had something in this which was probably not a bacterium. And he commented on that, but he didn't quite go far enough to think he had a new type of organism. He speculated that maybe he was dealing with a toxin. So diseases like cholera, which are caused by a bacterium, Vibrio cholerae, actually secrete a toxin. And if you give an individual or a test animal the toxin, which is a smallish molecule, a protein, which will go through the filters, you will get the symptoms of disease. So maybe he was dealing with a toxin. Or possibly, and he speculates that maybe his filters had a flaw and he was letting bacteria through. So those are his two explanations. So he didn't quite make the leap to saying he'd discovered a new class of organism. So probably slightly unduly modest, maybe. And it was really left up to Martinus Bayerink, working in Delft, who published an absolutely classic paper in 1898. And he used the term contagium vivum fluidum, a contagious life fluid, because he did similar experiments to Ivanovsky, but he took them further, and he showed that if you took the filtrate through his filters and put them on more tobacco plants — we're dealing with the same disease here, now it's known as tobacco mosaic virus — and put them onto other plants, yes, he could get the disease, but he got more material back and he could keep on passing it. So a toxin would actually get diluted and you just lose the effect quite quickly. This, you'd get more and more and more material. So it was somehow living. It was a living contagious fluid. And rather remarkably, in this 1898 paper, he actually just drops in the word virus, which is the first use for describing a novel type of organism. He just uses it, and it's a Latin word, which simply means poison or slime and unpleasantness. So this virus I'm dealing with, this disease-causing stuff. And of course, that name just stuck for ever since. So he is credited with the father of virology and that whole recognizing a whole new class of organisms, which are not bacteria, are not free living. You couldn't see them. He could do experiments to get a rough idea of their size through diffusion through agar. It's a very intriguing experiment he did. And so he concluded this wasn't really a thing like a bacterium, but some kind of liquid molecule which was doing it. And that's really, that late 19th century is really the beginning of this whole recognition of a whole new class of organisms. And then I won't go on too many galleries of sort of black and white images of people rather formally dressed. But there were, a lot of work was done by people like Wendell Stanley in the US, who actually managed to crystallize tobacco mosaic virus. This is very odd for a living organism. You can make crystals of it and you can purify it. He actually thought it was mainly a protein, which it is, but it was at the same time, roughly, Fred Borden and Nick Perry in Rothamsted actually showed there was nucleic acid in these particles. And this was before it was known that nucleic acid was the genetic material, but he knew there was some within the particles. And then we had the first visualization of particles by Helmut Ruska, who was actually the brother of Ernst Ruska, who invented the electron microscope. Because with the electron microscope, you can see things far smaller. And there you could resolve, you know, particles of a virus for the first time. And then some experiments, wonderful experiments by Heinz Frankl Conrad in the US, where he actually managed to take this material such that Stanley and Borden had isolated, which seemed, you know, really quite inert in a test tube. It wasn't growing, it was crystalline material, and actually showed you could dismantle it into the protein and the nucleic acid components, which in their own, in his experiments, were non-infectious. And you'd mix them together again, and you'd reconstitute an infectious virus, which you could then use to infect more plants. And it led to such headlines as life created in a test tube. And that was in the mid-50s. And so all this led to our view of tobacco mosaic virus as these rod-shaped particles like this, with the a central hole and a helical structure. And I've got here a three-dimensional model. Now, if we were actually in a lecture theatre at the moment, I could pass these around for you all to look at, because it's nothing like handling something like a three-dimensional entity. But I hope you can see on the screen that, you know, it's a helical structure. And indeed, the particles are actually hollow. And the RNA is actually at a certain distance, encapsulated by these multiple copies of the same co-protein. A real particle of these kind of lengths would have about over 2,000 co-protein molecules within them. And they're very, very stable like this. Now, subsequent work, classic work, was done by someone who's very famous, Rosalind Franklin. And most people know about her through her work on the DNA structure of the double helix. But she was very much into helical structures, and actually was the first one to get a detailed picture of tobacco mosaic virus. And this is a model which was actually exhibited at the World's Fair in Brussels in 1958. And this isn't taken at the World's Fair, but is at the time when this was taken, in a corridor at the Laboratory of Molecular Biology in Cambridge. And a lot of the work on working out the principles of virus structure was undertaken by Rosalind Franklin's PhD student, Aaron Klug, who with Don Casper enunciated the principles of virus construction, which is universal for viruses of plants, animals, bacteria, and really laid the foundations for structural virology. And actually, just on a personal note, I came into all this on working on TMV in 1976, and that's actually a photo of me with a tobacco plant, just as I was about to start my PhD. And the reason I mention this is, well, two things. I was Ellen Klug's PhD student, so in a way, I was Rosalind Franklin's grand student, if there was to be such a thing. Now, unfortunately, I never met her because she died very young, but I like to think of that lineage. I also used to walk past that model every day on my way into the lab and leaving it as well. So a little bit of a personal note. Okay, so the fundamentals of virus structure, what's in these things? So basically, the vital thing is they're intracellular parasites that can only multiply within living cells. You can't culture them on plates like you can bacteria, and that was one of the problems. They need to get into a cell and then they can multiply. And it has to be a living cell. And that's actually one of the other things that BioLink discovered, that you did need living cells to get more virus infection. You can't just put them on a dead piece of plant material. The genetic information is contained within the particles. This can be DNA or RNA, and double or single-stranded. A lot of plant viruses, in fact, the majority, are RNA viruses, as are a lot of animal viruses. And of course, we've heard a lot about coronavirus, and that is indeed an RNA-containing virus, single-stranded RNA. And the RNA, maybe that's the gene, or indeed the DNA, this is actually quite unstable material, particularly RNA. And so you get these multiple copies of one or more types of coat protein around the nucleic acid that forms a shell to protect it. And so enabling the virus to be transmitted through the environment, because the genome wouldn't actually survive that way or be able to get into the cells. And some viruses have an additional outer layer provided by a membrane derived from the host cell. And these are what are known as envelope viruses. And that actually does include the current SARS coronavirus, the causative agent of SARS-CoV-2, the causative agent of COVID-19. So it's an envelope virus containing single-stranded RNA. So the question is, I mean, I've described some of the odd effects of viruses and what they do and the diseases they cause, or even the economic bubble they can cause. Now, how can you turn it into an ally? How can you turn a plant virus into an ally? How can it help you? Well, the great thing about viruses, the particles have dimensions on the nanoscale, and they're generally highly regular. And so you can try and make use of that property. So when I say highly regular, I've already shown you the model of TMV here, but you can have other shapes. And this is a virus I'm going to talk about shortly, is a thing called Kalpi mosaic virus, which is isometric. So, and it looks like a sphere. In fact, this has got these protrusions here. It looks sometimes like, you know, the pictures of something like a marine mine, which you see in pictures of sometimes in war films. You can also get slightly more complex structure, and this is what's known as a Gemini virus, because it has two, there's these twinned particles, hence Gemini. And if you remember the picture I showed you of that cassava field, where some of the plants would have this mosaic symptoms, it's this type of virus, which actually contains single-stranded DNA, that causes that kind of symptoms in the cassava plant. So this is a Gemini virus, a slightly different structure. And you can get even more complex structures, such as a thing called a bacteriophage. And this has a bit of an isometric bit on the top and a helical bit underneath with a few fibers. And it's called a bacteriophage because it kills bacteria. Phage, it's bacterial eating, literally. And these things were actually discovered in about 1915. And some of these have been put forward as a way of combating viral infections, i.e. kill the bacteria with a virus, a bacteriophage. They can self-assemble, and I mentioned the work of Frankel Conrat, and they're biocompatible. Obviously, they get into cells and they exist within cells. You can genetically and chemically manipulate them, these outer surfaces, and plant viruses are particularly good at this because you can get a lot of them. It's one of the reasons that they tended to be used for the early studies in the first half of the 20th century, because you can actually isolate more larger amounts of the particles than is easily done with animal viruses. And so a lot of this kind of work has been done with plant viruses for practical reasons. The genomes within them, the RNA or the DNA, is small, and you can actually adapt that to use to actually express other proteins called expression vectors. And basically the way viruses work is they get into a cell and they take over the metabolism of the cell and subvert it to make more copies of themselves. As I say, they're intracellular parasites. And there are all sorts of different shapes and sizes, and I've shown you the models of some. You get these icosahedral ones, isometric ones, quite small. You get these small bacteriophage, you get these rod-shaped viruses, this TMV again. This thing is a bacteriophage, infects and will kill bacteria. And so you can get these regular structures, and I showed you the more complex ones as well. You can also get very odd shapes, particularly if you go to things like hot springs, because they're bacteria which live in these very harsh environments, but they too have their own viruses. So there's this virus called the beer bottle virus. And of course, this is like a meme because, strangely enough, I know maybe you'll be amazed to hear they don't actually have beer labels on them, but they actually do look like beer bottles under the electron microscope. So you do get these rather odder shapes as well, often made of a combination of the different, more regular shapes added together. And over the years, a number of these viruses have been extensively studied. One of the particular ones, and one of the reasons for this, is that it was one of the first viruses isolated and has been extensively studied over the years, is our old friend tobacco mosaic virus, TMV. And all sorts of things have been, you know, I won't expect anyone to look through all this, but it's been used for scaffolds, for biomolecules, for pharmaceuticals, vaccines, all sorts of nanotechnology, such as electrodes and light harvesting systems, because it's such a robust scaffold on a nanoscale. And also for, as I mentioned, this thing, catalysis. And this actually shows a particle in the process of assembly. Now, I'm now going to talk a little bit about my favorite virus, which is Cowpea mosaic virus. Now, this was isolated actually in 1959, so a little bit of a Johnny come lately, as it were, compared with TMV. Isolated in cowpea fields in West Africa. And cowpeas are important for the seeds they produce, which are either known as black-eye beans or black-eye peas. And so they're a source of nutrition, very rich in protein. And so having this disease, which reduces the yield of the pods, was important to control. And these are transmitted actually by beetles, leaf-feeding beetles. And this is the symptom, you can see why it gets its name, causes a mosaic on cowpea leaves compared with a healthy plant. And if you look at the particles in the electron microscope, we have these nice isometric, which means equal size in all directions, sometimes known as spherical particles, although they're a bit angular to be really spherical, and this gives you the scale. So they're about 30 nanometers across. And if you look through either crystal structures or with the modern cryo-electron microscopes, you can get the real detail of how the proteins lie in these particles. So this is a much greater magnification of one of those particles. The colors, of course, are arbitrary, just to mention the two types of coat protein, one type shown in blue, the other in green. And you can actually separate a preparation of these particles into empty particles, the ones containing the two different genomic RNAs, RNA1 and RNA2, and they're just shown here. Now, for plant viruses, having a split genome is really quite common. So you don't just have a single RNA in a type of particle. So you can have the genome, as I say, split in this case in two. You also get split genomes in animal viruses. And a classic is that of influenza, which normally has eight segments. But the difference is those eight segments are all in the same type of particle, whereas these are in two different, these are separately encapsulated in the particles. So you get RNA1 in these particles down here, RNA2 in those type of particles. And these particles produced by infection are actually very versatile as a nanoparticle. And there's been a lot of work on them, actually going back to the early 1990s. And you can genetically and chemically modify the surface, so the outer surface. And so here's my model I showed earlier of the particles. You can actually alter how the surface looks, and you can actually dress it up to look like an animal virus if you want. You can chemically attach things to it. You can put other bits of protein on, or you can put all sorts of different kind of molecules. You can do things which make the particles electroactive, and you can, you know, potentially use those in nano circuitry. You can construct layers. You can use it just as a material rather than the virus. And you can also, all sorts of templates for mineralization. You can coat it with metals to use it to get things of a constant size. So very useful. And these have been used in biomedicine. And I was going to draw attention to some work, and this is now 25 years old, where you could actually just dress up infectious virus of this plant virus with this thing called mink enteritis virus, which is very similar to canine parvovirus. Just put a small sequence of the mink enteritis virus on the outer surface, and then you can test these in these animals. This is a mink. I have to say, in this case, it's a stuffed mink, because they're far easier to photograph when they're not moving. Somebody lent me. And you can actually know, this is, I deliberately kept this as an old slide to show how old this work is, that you can vaccinate with this modified plant virus. And actually, if you do that, none of them get the disease. So you can make a vaccine against an animal virus from a plant virus. And as I say, this is about 25 years ago now when this initial work was done. And there's been a huge amount of work subsequently, a lot of it done by a former PhD student at the John Innes Institute, Nicole Steinmetz, looking at combating cancers by injecting them tumours with Kappa mosaic virus, or indeed other plant viruses. And these are to do with particles generally just produced by infecting. So you've got a functional plant virus particle, which in some cases is then modified. In some cases not. I mean, you can just formulate the particles to have an effect. But there's an issue that we came up with using particles produced using the natural infection pathway of a plant virus, Kappa mosaic virus. There are limits to the genetic changes you can make to the viral surface, because it's got to be functional as a virus. And if you change the surface too much, it won't work in the plant. And so you don't get anything back. Even if you're going to then say, well, I'm going to make the changes after I've purified the particles with the wild type virus, it's still restricted to what you can do by the natural amino acid on the surface of the particle and the chemical groups associated with them. They contain viral nucleic acid and they're therefore infectious to plants, not to animals. So you do run into some regulatory issues there. And the fact that you've got the viral RNA in there means there's no room to put anything else. Now, viral RNA, or RNA, actually can be useful to get an immune response, can help. So it's not necessarily a bad thing totally, but having an infectious nucleic acid, infectious RNA, is generally not highly thought of. But unfortunately, you can't put anything you want in if they're already full. And so the solution would be to make synthetic empty virus-like particles, EVLPs, and we call them. So the question is, how are you actually going to do that? And this is where another strand of the work I'm involved in comes in. And that's the development of a system for what's known as transient expression in plants. And the two strands will meet again, but I'm just going to briefly describe what's involved in that and also show a video of it. So what you want to do, the great thing about transient expression is you're going to introduce nucleic acid encoding a protein that you want to make via what I call nature's own genetic engineer, a thing called Agrobacterium tumefaciens, or you can do it directly with a plant virus, but even that's done mainly by Agrobacterium now. And that's a soil living bacterium, which actually in this native state causes crown galls in plants, but it delivers part of its own DNA into the plant. The introduced sequence doesn't modify the plant genome in a heritable manner. So you're not making transgenic plants. You're not going to get lines of plants, but it'll enable the protein you're interested to be expressed just in wild type plants. And the expression occurs in a matter of days after introduction of the gene. It's essentially a batch process because you can't get seeds which are modified. And you can actually adapt the components of Kappa mosaic virus to develop such a system. And I mentioned the genetic material in Kappa mosaic virus, and I'm going to come back to it. The smaller of the RNAs here encodes the two co-proteins called large and small. We're very imaginative, us virologists, and this thing called the movement protein. Turns out what you can do is you can remove most of that region and just leave the bits at the ends here. And those bits will make a messenger RNA. So we'll have a 5' and a 3' UTR. And you can clip those efficient sequences to a gene of your interest, to express a protein of your interest. In this case, we're using the green fluorescent protein because it's very easy to see when you shine UV light on it. And you can just inject, this is actually injecting living bacteria under the epidermis of Australian dwarf tobacco, which is a relative of the main tobacco which makes up smoking material. But this is a thing called, it's a rather easier host to work with. And in the region you inject, if you wait about a week, you'll see the green fluorescence under ultraviolet light. And by changing the sequence of these two ends, you can actually increase the level if you want to do it and get the maximum amount out of it. So what's actually going on with these things? I'm going to try and stop having a laser pointer, so I'll just go back to my cursor. And it's a mysterious process. The absolute details are not 100% known, but I'll just give you an idea of what's actually going on. So let's see, we want to express a particular gene. And here it is, here's the classic double helix, just in of somewhere we want to get that particular sequence expressed. Basically, you can cut it out from the original organism, and you can put it into this circular DNA called a plasmid. And here it comes in, and for those familiar, the process is known as ligation. It sounds like that. And then you can take the plasmid DNA, and what you do, you grow your agrobacterium on a plate. Remember, these are bacteria, so these will grow on an agar plate, and they're motile. And this is a representation, a cartoonish representation of them. According to that, and the purple bit's the bit you've put into the plasmid, and this will all be multiplied within the bacterium. Then you grow the bacteria, and all you do is take them up in a syringe on a small scale, and you inject them under the epidermis, and this is a Australian dwarf tobacco plant, and you soak the region, and then you go inside the cell in that soaked region. And you can see, I hope, the sun's shining down from the top. You can see the cells, which are, of course, much bigger than the bacterium. But where they get coated with proteins, and all those proteins begin to go out into the cytoplasm. And I've chosen to make them purple. These little tetrahedrons are subunits of a virus particle. So the region expressing those is purple. And actually, the self-assembly protein, those viruses self-assemble, will make your particles for you. And you can then extract them and use them. So this is a very useful process because it's quick. You can go through it. And you can get something from the very beginning in about a month. So it's very responsive. It's also scalable. And this is some idiot with a syringe doing a small scale into a tobacco leaf here, bench scale. You can use pilot scale vacuum. You can reverse the process and dunk your plants in a soup of agrobacterium, reduce the pressure, and the air comes out of the intercellular spaces within the leaves. And once you reduce the pressure, the agrobacteria gets sucked up into all or most of the leaf tissue. And you can automate that. And here's just a greenhouse in a company called Medicargo a few years ago, where you can do large scale infiltration. So you can make a lot, you can industrialize it. And there's the kind of yields on a weekly basis. And this just explains how simple it is if you want to make a simple virus-like particle. You just make your plasmid, amplify it in normal bacteria, E. coli, transfer it into this soil-living bacterium, do your agroinfiltration, and because you get self-assembly, you're going to get the particles made. And this is of a fish virus called nervous necrosis virus. And we've actually done experiments with those particles, and they will actually protect fish against that disease, which is an important problem of aquaculture. And using this kind of system, and these are the plasmids we use, you can make all sorts of particles. This is something from bovine papillomavirus. Other people have used the system to make human papillomavirus particles. You can make particles of another virus. This is one used in nanotechnology. This is our nervous necrosis virus. You make hepatitis B core particles, which are very useful for carriers, for other foreign sequences. And you can get more complicated because all these four are just made of a single type of coat protein. But you can co-express four different coat proteins to make particles of a thing called blue tongue virus. And these are four types of coat proteins arranged in three concentric shells. And all the information is within the proteins themselves. And that will simply self-assemble. If you express the four coat proteins in the right ratio, you'll get the particles. You don't have to assemble them yourself. And here you will have our friend Calpe mosaic virus, the particles there. And finally, something which is related to Calpe mosaic virus, they're both members of the same order of viruses, poliovirus. And I'm just going to talk a little bit more about these two. So don't worry, I'm not going to talk about all of them in detail. So to produce particles of Calpe mosaic virus, these things, in this case, you can see they're two coat proteins, in this case, colored in yellow and green. This would be the blue protein in the diagram. You actually need the precursor of the two coat proteins and a source of a protease needed to cleave between them. And that can be provided by a separate construct expressing the protease or a full-length molecule of RNA-1, the other component, because the protease is encoded by that. And if you co-express them, you get nice particles. And you think, well, they look good. So I won't go through. I showed you those nice pictures of the cryo-EM reconstructions. But I'll just say the great thing about those is you can actually use those empty particles to package an RNA of your choice using our knowledge of the packaging mechanism. Because we know that the way the RNA is incorporated in the particles is linked to the replication of the RNA within cells, you can specifically encapsulate an RNA of your choice. And so you can end up here, let me go back to this, with the laser pointer, you can actually make a designer RNA of your choice within the particles. And you can even modify the outer surface to target that RNA to cells of your choice. And there's a lot of interest in RNA-based therapeutics. And of course, we've heard a lot about RNA vaccines recently. And also, you can use the fact that you can package RNAs to make positive controls for PCR, which you can add to human samples, because RNA on its own is very prone to degradation. We'll just add RNA on its own to a sample, a clinical sample, it would be degraded. Now, there's a bit of detail here, which it's not, don't need to go into details of. You can put all these RNAs in which have primer binding sites for PCR. So the sequences are all the ones recommended by the WHO. You can put these into agrobacterium, infect plants, get your RNA package, and then use these the added virus-like particles containing the thing which looks like SARS-CoV-2 RNA, so it's a mimic for it, and you can either use it to calibrate your machinery, or you can actually add it to the human samples. So you can use it to actually calculate the amount of viral RNA from the SARS-CoV-2 in samples by comparison with known amounts of controls. Now, these Calpe mosaic virus containing parts of SARS-CoV-2 RNA. It's only a part, containing the spike protein. So these are totally non-infectious. So these can be easily handled and distributed, often for proficiency testing. And are they useful in practice? Well, yes, we've done some work with St George's Hospital in Tooting in London. And here you can see you can measure the amount. Here's the trace you get from quantitative PCR with the actual sample within, you know, the infectious SARS-CoV-2. And you validate the reaction by detecting separately your plant virus-based mimic. So it's a very good way of ensuring that your reactions, PCR reactions, are valid. But also, as I said, you, by actually varying the amount you add, you can actually titrate the amount of authentic virus. And these controls are actually used in Norwich, in the Norwich Research Park testing facility for routine testing for SARS-CoV-2. People who are potentially infected with COVID-19, because it validates all the PCR. So, of course, you're not just stuck with making cowpea-mosaic virus particles or empty virus-like particles. You can make other things. And the one example I'm going to give, or actually a little one and a half examples is probably better, is the production of poliovirus-like particles. Now, I mentioned this actually is a distant relative of cowpea-mosaic virus. And what you have to do there, why you want to do this, is there is a need for a new source of vaccines, because in the absence of RNA, the virus-like particles of polio are very unstable, and they undergo this change from a form which is very good at giving you protecting you from polio to one which won't, from D to C. And you need stabilized particles, and you need a lot of them. So can you make these in plants for distribution to help protect against poliovirus? Well, using our knowledge of cowpea mosaic virus, we make a coat protein precursor. In this case, you've got three main structural proteins. We have the, put that in one plasmid, the 3CD protease used for its processing, and then you co-express them. And you want stabilized particles, so we're very fortunate to have collaborators at a place called the National Institute of Biological Standards and Control, just north of London. And you can do a bit of classic virology of simply passaging the polioviruses at increasing temperature, select the stable ones, and then they send us the sequences that they've selected for the stable coat proteins, just as a Word document. And we can make these, and you can end up making stabilized virus particles. And these are isolated from plants. They look like poliovirus. And if you look in the antigenicity, they have nice deform, the majority, just like the inactivated salt vaccine. So they look very promising. You can get their structure from cryo-EM. This is done in collaboration with the University of Oxford, and they look like empty particles. And they can actually protect mice against challenge with poliovirus. So there we have a candidate anti-poliovirus vaccine made in plants. And just finally, to be a bit more current, and this is just preliminary work, we've actually done some work on SARS-CoV-2, the causative agent of COVID-19. And these are the various structural proteins. This is, it's a slightly old slide, this is the old name for SARS-CoV-2. And what we're expressing of the structural proteins, the spike, the E and the M. And these are all, this is an envelope virus, and so these are in the outer envelope. And this is just some preliminary work showing that you could actually express the spike protein. This is detected immunologically on the surface. And you do get assembly into something which looks like a virus-like particle, but we're not totally sure, so we called it a virus-like particle, light particle, possibly. But it has a characteristic appearance of a coronavirus, and this is actually extracted from plants. And of course, we're doing far more testing on that. And of course, there are other vaccines around as well against that based on various methods. So it just remains for me to say, and I do apologize once more, I had to speed up a bit, obviously, to get everything done after that little break. But just to thank everyone over the years who's been involved. Now, I thought I could just give a long list of names, but I won't do that. More photographs, and some people, they may have tuned in, may recognize themselves. But all the various people over the years. So right at the beginning in the 1990s, And yeah, that's what I looked like then, for the early days on working on infectious virus and that work with on the mink. Our collaborators, and still are collaborators, that's Jack Johnson in California, people at the John Innes, visiting an agricultural show, in case you wonder what a British blonde is. It's a breed of cattle, but it was just an amusing photograph. And then in more recent years, the various people in my group, up until a year or two ago. And of course, it's more difficult in the last couple of years to get a photograph of everyone because we're supposed to socially distance. And of course, you don't actually get that far without funding. And the main funding for the work I've spoken about has come from the John Innes Center, the World Health Organization, for that's specifically to do the work on polio, but also largely supported by the BBSRC, which is the research council, which funds a lot of this work in the UK. So it just remains for me to thank you all for listening, and sorry about the technical hitch in the middle.
Again. Yes, and what I'd like to remind our audiences is that the John Innes Center is one of our content partners on this exhibition. And we are absolutely delighted to be partnering with them for the second time. The first time we worked together with them was on Phytopia, which was our pop-up exhibition on everything plants, because of course the John Innes Center is about everything plants. We have really enjoyed working with them, and it seems to be the case that they've also enjoyed working with us, because it's good to see them back. I'll say a little bit more about the exhibits we have from the John Innes Center in the exhibition in a wee bit. But I did want to say one thing before we move on to the question and answers, is that Wendell Stanley's crystallization of the tobacco mosaic virus is a part of the exhibition. So do go have a look, and you'll be able to hear him speak as well. It's quite an interesting exhibition, and some of the images that George showed are also there, and you can read about them. You can observe them in further detail, etc. So let us go ahead with the questions. And oh my God, they're like piling on now. Yes. Okay, so the first question, George, I must admit, I am a historian of science, so you will forgive me if I bring to you questions that I should know, I shouldn't. There's a question, do viruses have a general charge?
That's an interesting thing. You mean on the surface of them? Yes, they do. Now, a lot of plant viruses, the surface is a bit acidic. So the way of putting it is the PI, which is where they're neutral. Of this thing, calcium mosaic virus, yeah, it's about six. So they will have a surface charge. And it's generally, if it's a plant virus, tends to be slightly acidic.
And what does it do?
What does the charge do? Well, it's important for its interactions, attachment to the cells initially. And also, of course, all plant viruses have to be vectored. Mm-hmm. Because plants can't move around, they're not airborne, and so the viruses have to attach not only to the plant cell but also to, say, the insect mouth parts. Mm-hmm. And the charge can be very important for actually attaching correctly so they can be vectored. Mm-hmm. And so that's an important side of things. If you have the wrong charge, often things will just bind irreversibly. Mm-hmm. And they won't be able to move anymore.
Uh-huh. Pragya wants to ask you, is there any instance where a viral particle can stop another virus, kind of competitive inhibition?
Yeah, well, yes, there is actually. That's a very good question. You'll often get this kind of phenomenon of virus exclusion. And so the people have done mixed infections of plants. One tends to dominate in any one cell. So the precise reason isn't entirely understood, but you'll tend to get, and there's also a very well-known phenomenon in bacteria called phage exclusion. And so it's almost as if it outcompetes. So you can imagine that, if you had a rather benign virus, could sort of outcompete a more virulent one, more dangerous one. You can sort of imagine that kind of thing happening. And rather like sometimes you use in agriculture, you'll use, say, a benevolent fungus to treat tree stumps to outcompete the more sort of pathogenic one. So you do get those kind of things which can happen. So, I mean, I don't think it's ever been used in medicine, apart from the fact that you use a mild virus to stimulate the immune system, prevent subsequent infection. with a much more serious one. And of course, that's the basis from that original work on cowpox and smallpox. And people probably know the story of Edward Jenner and protecting James Phipps by giving him pustules from a dairy maid who had cowpox, because he noticed that dairy maids who often got these pustules from milking cows never got smallpox. And so he rationalized he could deliberately use that. And he used it to protect people. And there was, that was the early, and that's where the term vaccination comes from. So vacca, cow. We get that term from back in the late 18th century in that case.
That's wonderful, because that connects very directly to a museum walkthrough that we've organized for Contagion of the Edward Jenner House and his museum and the cowshed where he developed the very first vaccines for cowpox and smallpox. So that was wonderful sort of intervention to connect back to something that's happening otherwise in the exhibition, but also an important story because we tend to use I think at least in the non-medical community, the word vaccination without thinking of where it originated from and what connections it has to the cow, for example. Yeah. Kathleen, sorry, yes, you were saying something.
I was going to say, believe it or not, I've actually, the cow was called Blossom. And apparently her hide is in St. George's Hospital in Tooting now, because Jenner had a position in London, as well as being a country doctor at St. George's Hospital. So Blossom's hide is apparently there. Now, whether it's really her hide, I don't know.
Well, it's like the numerous sticks of that belong to Moses.
Yes.
One or two of which I have myself seen, but I have absolutely no problems going to see Blossom's hide, whether it's in one place or two. But it is an interesting story, and I think it's the history of activities that we kind of refer to, but not necessarily connect back to, which makes an experience of this kind in an exhibition season rich, but also gives us various hooks to connect into the story of vaccination, of pandemics, of viruses. Kathleen has a question for you. Do your VLPLPs have a membrane?
Yes, they do. And that'll be derived from the host plant. And so the thing sticking out would be the spike protein embedded in a plant-derived membrane. Now, normally, during an infection, it would be a membrane in a human cell. But it looks like you can put these in, membranes from a number of different systems. Yeah, I mean, you can culture the virus in different cells. And so, yes, and the membranes seem to come from the plant.
Supriya has the following question. What could you tell us about the use of plant viruses for genome editing?
Oh, now that's again a very interesting question, because one of the interesting uses you could put the technology to is to deliver the enzymes and the RNAs for genome editing, because that's one of the issues, is how you get them into the plant. And so we've been having discussions about how we can use some of our technology to deliver either the guide RNAs or the nuclease or both within an encapsulated entity to try and use transient expression to drive up the efficiency of editing. So it's a very interesting point. So there's a lot of work on, actually making that process more efficient.
So her further question is, do you suggest any other candidate virus other than TRV to be used in plant gene editing?
Oh, well, yes, TRV is used, and it's has a structure. I mean, it's a bit wider, but it has that kind of a structure. And it's been used because it spreads and it's used for gene silencing. You could use other viruses. You might want one of these because, you can put more things in them. You can imagine putting the enzymes in here. It's quite difficult to do that with a rod-shaped one. So yes, I can imagine other viruses will be adapted. Obviously a very important technique now, genome editing.
One of our attendees wants to know if viruses can kill other microbes like fungi.
Definitely, absolutely definitely. So you get fungal viruses, and they've been proposed, and I think actually in some cases actually deployed, to prevent pathogenic fungi causing, you know, killing plants in agriculture. You actually, you know, can treat with those kind of viruses for fungi. You can definitely have bacteriophage, bacterial eating viruses, and they've been proposed for actually for use in medicine. Certainly put forward, actually Alexander Fleming, of course, famous for penicillin, actually had that proposal to use them, and they will kill human pathogenic bacteria, but it's difficult to maintain that for very long. But also you can, there's been in ideas that you could actually use certain of their products to, you know, kill bacteria involved in, say, food spoilage. And so food could be preserved for longer.
So Mustafa has a question for you. Are the isolation and purification protocols same for all the VLPs from the expression system of the plant and the candidate viruses?
They tend to have general principles which are similar because of their size. So there's a lot of the purification is based on size, and you can sediment them through gradients or filter them on based on their size. They do vary a bit because we mentioned the surface charge can be different. Viruses have a certain surface charge, and that can influence what kind of buffer composition you use. You tend to have to sort of refine it a bit for each particular virus. But the general principles, yeah, they're quite similar, in fact, the kind of things we do, which basically relying, you know, on using size as the basis of discrimination.
Kathleen has two questions, but I'll read them one by one. Is there a close cousin to CPMV? Can it mix RNAs with related cousin viruses?
Yeah, it is actually, it has some close relatives. It's a member of a group called the comoviruses. Mm-hmm. Which gets the name from that. And there's close relatives. To be honest, when you try and do a mixed infection, you tend to get particles, they tend to stick to themselves, really. You can get a mixed infection, but you'll get the RNA of one only in the particles made by the co-protein of that. And I think that relates to the fact that replication and assembly is very closely linked. And so you get a replication of one RNA and it makes the co-protein. And so it's there. So the other, any other co-protein doesn't get a look in. Now you can, with things like TMV, do cross-assembly in vitro. So you can get close relatives and actually you'll get, heterologously, mixed particles, as long as they're closely related.
Okay. So there are two very specific questions, which are clearly from people who are from your field. I'm going to prioritize a different question, which comes from a member of the public at large who's slightly embarrassed about the question, but still wants to know the answer.
It's probably going to be a very good one.
I think so. Absolutely. How do plants fight the virus back?
Exactly. That's all. Yeah. That's, extremely good point. Now, yeah. Plants don't have an immune system in the sense that mammals do. They don't make antibodies. But they do have this thing called the gene silencing pathway. And so what happens is, say, we'll talk about an RNA virus, the ones I'm most familiar with. When the RNA comes in, and it's, say, a single-stranded RNA, it's copied to make a double-stranded form of RNA. So it's got both strands. And that gets recognized by the plant as something alien and foreign. Mm. And it kicks off a whole cascade of enzymes, which actually chops that RNA into little bits. And it silences the gene. And it actually, will prevent the virus, continuing and infecting. And you'll often find you sometimes find that plants will recover from a virus. They'll grow out of it. So you'll get an infected leaf and then the new shoots will be healthy. And that, a lot of the studies of that led to our understanding of this whole process. And as a counter defense, the viruses then make proteins which disrupt the silencing pathway. So it's a real sort of arms race you get. So the plants then try and inhibit that silencing pathway. And then again, that tends to, you know, the plants move on, and and the various lines will have resistance genes, which use a different mechanism usually. But there's this whole silencing pathways, how plants defend themselves against viral infections.
Okay, so Anne has a question, which I think follows from that. Can the vaccine for COVID-19 be made from plants? I mean, that's just an example. Can the vaccine be made from plants, which can protect us from variant viruses of COVID-19?
There's a company in Canada who are doing just that, called Medicargo. And actually, it's one of those coincidences that some of the testing is being done, you know, some of the volunteers are being recruited in Norwich. So it's possible that some of my colleagues in Norwich might actually be able, you know, take part in a phase 3 clinical trials. So certainly you can make those particles into potential vaccines for real deployment.
So Abdul's question then, I might actually follow from there, where he says, is there any demerit or is there any sort of disadvantage of using viruses as expression vectors?
Yes, I mean, historically, if you try to get a replicating vector, if you insert something to get the high yield, often what you found was you'd lose the inserted sequence because it wasn't selected for. Hmm. And that's been one of the disadvantages, that you just tend to what you call revert back to the wild type. When they're using just bits of viruses, just to get expression, you're not getting replication in that case. That you eliminate that problem. I mean, one of the issues of using plants generally is that there are slight differences in the proteins you get out, particularly in terms of the sugar residues which are put on the proteins, what's called the post-translational modifications. And so they're somewhat different between plants and animals. Now, in many cases, it doesn't make any difference for the immunological or the biological properties. But in some cases, some cases it does. And so you have to monitor that. Plus, of course, the issue you sometimes get, you're going to get slightly different impurities, maybe something from a plant you wouldn't get from, say, an animal cell. And you have to look out for that.
So I'm guessing the next question has been partly answered, because Anuj wanted to understand how you would broadly sort of, classify the differences or understand the differences between plant and animal viruses. But maybe do you want to answer that to elaborate that a little more, or do you think that's been answered?
Well, I mean, I can say that, I mean, there are some groups of viruses which have members which infect both plants and animals. So there'll be things, relatives of polio, much closer than Kappa mosaic virus, which are classified as the same group, which infect plants rather than animals. And certainly some of the double-stranded RNA viruses, it's called rhoviruses, you get plant-infecting members and animal-infecting members. So there isn't some absolute difference between them. There are slight differences. They adapt to their hosts. But there isn't some great big divide between them.
Okay, that's interesting to know. So potentially there could be, and that's the next question I have from Anvesha, there could be the zoonosis equivalent of plant and human sort of infections.
Yes, that's one of the concerns people have. As far as I know, there's never been an example, one of the convincing I've seen, that of a plant virus infecting human cells, cells in culture. And of course, I mean, plant viruses are ubiquitous, and they've never been regarded as posing a hazard to human health. You might see, a virus-infected apple, but you might say, I don't like the look of it, but you're not going to say, oh my God, that's dangerous, I won't go near it. So, I mean, no one's, worried about plant viruses, in terms of, eating contaminated food. I mean, they worry about them because they may reduce the yield. And of course, I mean, you see those tulips I showed with the breaking. I mean, those are highly prized and are used in people's homes because people like them. People are not afraid of them in any sense. Likewise, there's a variety of honeysuckle with this vein clearing symptoms. Again, highly prized. It's caused by again, caused by a virus infection. So they're not regarded as dangerous, as pathogens at all. I could not rule out 100% that an individual virus particle might be able to replicate in cells and culture, but I've never seen any good evidence for that.
Okay. Prabhu would like to know if you've ever observed a correlation between symmetry of a virus and its virulence.
That's interesting. I've not actually thought of that. The symmetry, you know, is, say, something like that more infectious than something like that? it tends to be more related to the genetic structure. What is an interesting thing is that in one particular group of viruses, or a virus called cucumber mosaic virus, often actually the ones which give you the highest yield, the most particles, the ones which give you the least effect on the plant, the milder symptoms. Now that makes a sort of sense. If it's not damaging the plant happily makes more of it. So there's that kind of correlation that actually the amount of the virus titer within the plants might sometimes inversely correlates with the disease severity.
So there's someone in the audience who appears to know you. It's Usha Ramakrishnan.
Oh, hello, Usha.
And she would like to know if you plan to make a CPMV-based vaccine for the coronavirus.
Well, yeah, I mean, so we've done some work I showed right at the end where we're using the transient expression. And I know Medicargo are doing a similar kind of strategy. There are other ways. You can actually dress the outer surface up. So in theory, you could do that. Or indeed, actually encapsulate the RNA inside the particles. So you'd have an encapsulated sort of RNA type delivery system.
So I'm going to ask you one last question, even though there are many more remaining, because for those of you who are aware, the young among the audience get to actually spend some time with George in a tutorial session. So would you have some summary thoughts or some summing up thoughts on the advantages and possibly disadvantages of plant expression systems over others?
Yeah. Well, I would say, transient expression, which I'll mention the stable transformation in a moment. So transient expression, it's quick. And I always like to say, you get your failures quickly. And that's not just joking. It means you can try things. You're not committing yourself down the long track for a year. Now, of course, there's a lot of work done on stable transformation, and that's to change the plant phenotype. Now, that's generally not used for this kind of vaccine kind of work, because it takes a long time to get the true breeding lines. And as we've seen with COVID-19, you get new variants, you have to respond, and it's a bit too slow. But it's used for, say, herbicide resistance or insecticidal proteins to protect from insect damage. So that is used for that. One of the potential downsides, although this hasn't really proved to be a major one, is differences. There might be differences in the proteins or the quality of the proteins you get out because of, you know, post-translational modifications. Of course, there are completely new methods which have really gone ahead very quickly, which don't actually involve making virus-like particles at all for vaccines, such as, you know, the RNA vaccines we've seen from Moderna and Pfizer-BioNTech. And so this terrible thing, that this scourge of a disease, has actually caused a huge resurgence of interest in new methods of making vaccines. It's rather like you get, you know, technological improvements during wartime. You don't want the war, but, you know, things like radar, etc.
Yes.
Developments were greatly stimulated. And it's a bit like that, you know, a sudden need and all the things. And there had been work on RNA vaccines and the adenovirus-based ones, but, you know, it had been slightly in the background, and suddenly these all come to be realised.
Yep. So, you know, my own early research was on the beginnings of experimental nuclear physics. And among the very early things we learned was that if it wasn't for the Manhattan Project, you know, while we knew about fission in 1939, we wouldn't have seen the nuclear bomb in 5 years flat if it wasn't for the war and the fear that, you know, the Germans would possibly deliver it, because most of the people who worked on the theoretical stuff at that point of time, Lisa Meitner, Otto Hahn, came from Germany.
Yeah.
And have German colleagues. So wartime, like pandemic times, and that is the analogy that's often used during pandemics, but, you know, inappropriately so probably, but it does sort of compress time in a sense and prioritizes things which otherwise were kind of latent and moving along slowly, etc. But thank you, George, for a wonderful lecture and for bringing to us an aspect of the study of viruses that tends to kind of get sidelined precisely in these contexts when, you know, when zoonosis and animal viruses and vaccines being produced, you know, plants kind of get sidelined. So I think it's good to be aware of the research that's ongoing and then the possibility of other kinds of vaccines that's playing in the background. So for, again, please allow me to remind you, do go and see the Wendell Stanley exhibit. And we have the Lindau lecture as well in the exhibition. And do have a look at what, I'm not probably allowed to say this, but what is one of my favorite exhibits in Contagion, putting the ant in antibiotics, which also comes from the John Innes Center, where we have a live stream from the laboratory where these ants are being studied for their chemical ecology in order to find different ways of handling the problem of antimicrobial resistance. These are leaf cutter ants, so I will not say more. Please do go have a look. Do give us your feedback and do visit our program. So as I said and mentioned earlier, we launch our Canada section or Canada version tomorrow with Vishu Guttel from the Indian Institute of Science speaking about public engagement and Indian languages. And join me again in thanking George for an engaging lecture and for also, you know, very interestingly answering all our questions with great patience. So thank you, George. It was a pleasure having you this evening.
You're welcome.
And look forward to future conversations. Thank you all.
Okay. Have a good evening. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.